All right, hello everyone again. It's this time of year again, where we already historically now, since we've been doing this for almost over 2 years, we get together and start discussing the possibility for the appeal of the licensed customs broker exam. So this time, the most current one, the latest one that has been in the news is April 2016, which was held on April 4th, 2016. And the topic of today is to explore the various possibilities of appealing some questions which, by looking at them, analyzing them, I think are worth appealing. Now, as always, I'd like to thank dear members of the Customs and Border Protection for making this possible, especially members of the Broker Management Branch for putting this together. Again, exam was by and large well written. And also I'd like to thank the members of the international trade community who really come and encourage me to continue doing these lectures and making it available to the public. So again, thank you for your support, and let's dive in. Before we dive in though, I want to mention that I'm gonna jump right into the substance. I'm not going to cover the procedure. The procedure hasn't changed much. However, if you are curious about the procedure, such as how many copies to include, such as what you need to, what type of documents you need to file, then what you need to do is you need to, first, there is a dedicated web page on the customs website, and it's right here. So you go to Home, Trade, Programs Administration, Customs Brokers, How to Appeal, and they customs kind of breaks it out for you. Okay. Now, in addition to that, I kind of a few years back I put together a presentation about ways of going about it. It is again suggested way. There is no hard and line rules as long as you stick to those outline points made by Customs and Border Protection. But if you'd like, there is a presentation. It's in October 2014 presentation. I talked about the procedure in some length, and I think it starts from minute 8 and it goes on for about an hour, maybe less, maybe more, but somewhere around that. And the way you can get to this presentation is by typing in. So you go to the main website of the project, which is lawcustoms.com, and from there, customs.com. So lawcustoms.com, and at the very top you will see those social media icons. You click on YouTube, and from YouTube you go to the playlists, right? And the playlist has a special dedicated section which is called Appealing Customs Broker License Exam. And over there you can get to this October 2014 examination and view the presentation that way. So that's the procedural part. Now, talking about the questions which are subject to appeal for the April 2016, those are the ones that I will be covering. Those questions are the ones that, in my view, are worthy of coming forward to customs and saying, look, Costas, I think my answer deserves at least equal consideration, if not better consideration, as opposed to the answer that you have provided. And also, those folks, this is, so we're going to talk about question 14, 15, 22, 48, 63, 65, 77, 80, right? So in this column, right, those are the CBP answers. And it's only worth for you to watch this presentation and really make a decision of whether or not to proceed with the appeal if you picked those answers. The NPCA abbreviation stands for no possible correct answer. In other words, please give me a credit because none of the answers fit the fact pattern or the call of the question to be examined. The other ones, if you are an examinee, right, and you picked B, then it's, and Customs said D, then it's worthy for you to appeal. However, if you picked C and Customs said D, for example, then it is not worth for you pursuing this because the argument which I will be discussing in this lecture will be geared toward answer choice B. Again, as always, I'm going to talk this through, and I'm going to put forward the reasons for the appeal. However, I provided the suggested text, which is available at the Law Customs store. So you go to, again, to the lawcustoms.com webpage, you go to store, and in the store, you will see the icon. You will see the icon which is available for purchase. Again, those are the written thoughts. So now I'm saying verbal thoughts. This will be the written thoughts, and this will be available for the limited time until the time to file the appeal expires. I believe it's July 8th. I may be wrong, but I think somewhere around that, the first part of July is the deadline to file the appeal. So that's concerning the written appeal part. And now let's dive into the questions. So I pulled up, I went straight to the CBP website to pull this up. So this will be, this is where you can get this also. So this is going to be the test which Customs has posted on its official website. And also we have the answer key which we'll be referring to. It is also on the Customs official website, which is available through the Customs broker subsection subpage. All right. So now we have covered the basics, and we're ready to go into the substance. So let's start from 14, and we'll go in the increasing order. All right. So number one. First question to be discussed would be the question number 14. So let's pull it up. Okay. Right there. Okay, so customs examiners would like to know which of the following circumstances, so they give you the list of circumstances, which of the following circumstances requires a separate entry for any portion of the split shipment. All right, so the call of the question is, obviously we have a split shipment. Split shipment is a buzzword. And another buzzword in a preceding statement and a preceding question is the separate entry. Separate entry. All right. So if you were preparing for the examination, you would probably know that CBP form 7501 instructions is a part of the required material. So let's visit that CBP form 7501 instructions and see what they say about entry. So as you can see, block 2 entry type in the instructions manual for the CBP form 7501 lists various type of entries. They list consumption entries. They list as which start with a zero. They list informal entries starting with one. They list warehouse entries starting with two, and they go on to list government and what we have transportation entries. So we know at least that under separate entry, since customs did not specify the entry type, we are dealing with separate entry, but we do not know which one, right? So what can we infer from this? We can infer from this that this can be entry for consumption or entry for transportation. Such as IT entry, immediate transportation without appraisement. So those are the various entry types. Now, let's go back to the question and let's look at the answer. So customs examiners say that the correct answer choice is D, right? The portion of merchandise that arrives to the that arrives 12 calendar days after the first portion. Well, customs examiners, what are they looking for? Is they are looking for your knowledge or your demonstration of knowledge of 19 CFR part, or rather section 141.57. And let's open up that section to see what it says. So again, where I'm getting this from, we're looking at the answer 14, 141.57. All right. So let's open up the CFR. And for the purposes of this lecture, I'm using the unofficial CFR. It is not, again, for the purposes of this lecture, I haven't found any differences between the current ECFR and the one that has been tested, at least on this question. As we discuss further, we'll see that there are some variations. But for the purposes of question number 14 on April exam, we are not concerned with that. And so I feel pretty confident about using this as a source for regulatory text. So all right, so we have it here. 141.57, single entry for split shipment. Let's open up and see what it says. Okay, so we can see that it says that it requires, basically, it's a rule which provides for entry, and the rule which provides for entry, it provides for entry which is split shipment, and there is a certain prerequisites, right, for the split shipment. So we have single conveyance, and which is the split intended by the importer, carrier on its own initiative decided to separate it out for whatever reasons. And if you want to, if you have any split shipment which arrives at different times or different ports, the question is, can you clear it on the one entry, the single entry? And the answer is, provided that you meet this criteria, yes, as long as you meet the 10 calendar day mold. All right. So 10 calendar day rule is a key. All right. So here we have a 10 calendar day rule. 10 calendar day rule. Day. And let's go and take a look at the question one more time. So, looking at the question, we can see that the 10 calendar day rule is being broken, right? Because the portion of the merchandise arrives 12 calendar days. So 2 calendar days too late for that split shipment to be on one entry. So that's one way of looking at it. But there's also a different viewpoint one can adopt when they answer this question. Let's go back to the 7501 instructions. So recall, we have various entries. We have consumption entry and transportation entry, right? And those are all entries. For example, the immediate transportation entry or transportation for immediate transportation without appraisement, it is addressed under part 18. So let's go to the part 18. And this is inbound entries. And here we can see the kinds of entries that are possible. And among those entries, we can see so following entries may be made for merchandise transport inbound. And the first one on the list, we see immediate transportation without appraisement, or commonly called an IT entry, immediate transportation entry. So let's go back to the question and look at example, look at the answer choice in number 14, which says, we're now looking at the C, which says C. So again, which of the following circumstances require a separate entry for any portion of split shipment? Answer choice C says, the portion of the shipment that arrived at a different port and was transported inbound to the port of destination where entry was made for the other portions of the shipment. So this is a fact pattern which we are stuck with. So can this answer the question which customs are looking for? So remember the buzzword, split shipment and separate entry, right? So we have the entry was made for the other portion of the shipment. So we have split shipment here, and we have a factual statement saying that the entry was in fact made. So here we have a split shipment prong met, right? Now, what about the separate entry? Now, looking at C, the portion of the shipping that arrived at a different port and was transported inbound. So recall what we saw in section 8 and 10, kinds of entry. So if you're gonna make a transportation inbound, you're gonna have to make an entry. And you're gonna have to probably, under the circumstances presented, unless it was made for exportation, it's going to be immediate transportation without appraisement. So here you have entry number one, which is IT, right? And then once, based on the examiner's fact pattern, you have entry number two, which was made for the other portions or along with the split shipment, which is entry number two, which is probably consumption. So you have IT entry and you have consumption entry. All right. So are those qualify as separate entries? Sure they are, because those are separate and distinct entries. So could you have transported, if you have a shipment at a different port, without making an inbound entry? Could you unite those two shipments that were split together? I don't see any other way. You can unite them by making separate consumption entries probably, but again, remember, we are stuck to the fact pattern that examiners provided us. And examiners clearly stated that there was an inbound entry made. It was transported inbound. In order for you to make it possible to transport inbound, you have to have that entry. You have to have that immediate transportation entry. So, is it a separate entry from the entry for consumption? Yes, of course. It is provided in a different section of the Code of Federal Regulations. It is a standalone entry, and moreover, it is pointed out as a separate entry on a required material such as CBP Form 7501 instructions. So, based on the fact pattern that was provided, this is the answer choice C is also good enough, right? Good enough. This is not where you stop, however, because remember, the criteria is the single best answer rule under the customs examiner's fact pattern. So if we move back to the instructions, we see each question is designed to have a single best answer. So the next thing you need to do, so once you established that the answer choice C fits the criteria just as well as D, you need to establish why is it the better answer than the answer choice D. And the way you can answer it is by going to the regulation which deals with the purpose of the examination, right? Remember the section which is dedicated to the customs brokers and the regulation which provides a cover for legal basis for the customs licensed customs broker exam. And this would be regulation number part 111, customs brokers. And you go to the written examination for individual license, section 111.13. And here we have a regulatory statement of the goal of the written examination. So it says the written examination for individual license will be decided according blah blah, and then we have the statement. The reason is to determine the individual's knowledge of customs and related laws, regulations, procedures, bookkeeping, accounting, and all other appropriate matters necessary to value to render a valuable service to importers and exporters. Now let's go back to that question 14. Notice that in answering, if you were to answer question D, you would only deal with this regulation 141.57, right? But in order to deal, if in order to answer question C correctly and be able to justify it, this alone is not going to fly. You also have to cover section 18.10 at the very least. So, in other words, this and in conjunction with this is a higher burden, right? And a higher burden means if you are able to articulate that this is a reason for you picking answer choice C, this means that you actually are more adept, you actually more sophisticated, your analytical thinking is more sophisticated than just analyzing D under the auspices of 141.57, because here you're going to have to kind of combine and understand that, hey, there is separate entries, right? Separate entries entail more than one type of entry. They also include immediate transportation entry. Immediate transportation entry is provided under 18.10, and therefore it is customs stated inbound, so 18.10 and 147 are interrelated. An ability to show this interrelationship gives you higher analytical standpoint and therefore is a better answer choice because it puts you in a more sophisticated position to provide the answer. So this is why it's a better answer, because it places more demanding knowledge level. It is not just straight 14157, but it is actually a combination of several regulations which you require to look at in order to answer this question with answer choice C. So this is a reason for picking answer choice C on question 14 for licensed customs broker examination, and it's also the reason why it's also the rationale why you want to say to customs that they should give you the credit if you indeed picked choice answer choice C as the answer choice on the customs broker exam. All right. So next on the list is we have question 15. Dutiable merchandise imported and afterwards exported, even though the duty thereon may have been paid on the first importation, is liable to duty on every subsequent importation into the customs territory, except, and you have a list of exceptions. All right. So this is a typical question which shows up quite often, and what it does is it takes a regulation. What customs examiners do is they take the regulation, they paste it, and they want to make sure that you are able to demonstrate, first of all, the knowledge of where it is, because in order to confirm that it is in fact correct, you need to look it up. So you need to know the section. So in this particular case, it would be 19 CFR section 141.2. That's number one. Number two will be the will also be the ability to actually understand what the statements in 141.2 stand for. So here we pretty much have a statement. So yes, you already brought this stuff into the country, but if you taking it out, the general rule is you have to pay duties again, unless you fit one of those exceptions. And there are numerous exceptions. Also, they have recently been expanded by the Trade Enforcement and Trade Facilitation Act of 2015 to include not only US products, but also other products which have been in the United States. But what we need to do here is we need to see, take a look at the regulation. So let's take a look. So customs says, customs examiners, so we are at question 15. So let's take a look at the answer key. So customs examiners say that the answer choice D is the correct answer. All right. So question 15, CBP says answer choice D. All right. So let's take a look at the regulation and see whether in fact D is fits the mold, fits the best answer rule mold. All right. So 141. So liability for duties upon reimportation. All right. So here we have a statement similar to the statement we saw in the fact pattern on question 15, which says duty on merchandise imported and afterwards exported, even though the duty thereupon may have been paid on the first importation, is liable on every subsequent importation, but it does not apply to the following. So we have a list of exceptions. We have personal household effects, professional books, automobiles, casks, articles, export for repairs and alterations, exhibitions, etc., etc. So Now let's go back to the exam question presented and let's see what it says. So we have customs saying that the dutiable merchandise imported and afterwards exported, even though the duty may have been paid, is liable for the duty except, and we have a list of statements, right? So what customs is saying is they are looking for an exception. They're looking to the exception to the general rule where you have to pay duty upon subsequent reimportation, right? And so in other words, we're looking for exception to the general rule and we know the laundry list, right? So let's start. So we have A, B, C, D, and E. So let's start with A. Personal household effects taken abroad by a resident who brought it back upon his or her return into the country. All right. So personal household effects taken abroad by a resident and brought back to the country. So that's true. That's an exception. You do not need to pay any duties, right? If you look at the call of the question, except personal household effects. So this is a go-go, right? Because it confirms that it is the exception to the general rule. Take a look at the next statement. Automobiles and other vehicles taken abroad for non-commercial use. Is that listed in the list of the exceptions? Automobiles and other vehicles under subparagraph C taken abroad for non-commercial use. So that's also within an exception. So B also fits the mold presented by the customs examiners. So far, notice what's going on. So customs are not looking at the exception to the exception. They are looking for the exception itself, exception to the general rule. This is the way it is phrased. So far, A is true. So far, and now we have automobiles, which is also true, right? So now something weird you may notice is going on, right? And the weird part is, we know that each question is designed to have a single best answer, but we have clearly at least two best answers that fit the course of the questioning conduct, right? So let's take a look at C. Articles exported for exhibition under certain conditions. All right, let's take a look at F. Articles exported for exhibition under certain conditions. And we have those conditions listed in part 10. All right, so now we have C, which fits the mold. So customs said D, so let's leave it and jump to the E. E, articles exported under lease to a foreign manufacturer. Is that also listed there? Let's see. Articles exported for repairs. Articles exported under lease to a foreign manufacturer. So we have H. H also fits the mold. So we have A, B, C, and E, which correspond to the statement. Now let's take a look at E. Let's take a look at D, which customs examiners say is the correct answer choice. Domestic animals taken abroad for temporary pasturage purposes and reunited within 11 months. So customs examiners state that this is an exception because if you take domestic animals abroad for pasturage purposes and return within 11 months, you do not need to pay any duties because this is an exception to the main rule. Let's see if that's true. That's true. Now, where we have animals, somewhere, right? Here, G. Domestic animals taken abroad for temporary pasturage purposes and returned within 8 months. So if you exceed 8 months, you have to pay duty, right? So look at the call of the question. You are being tested on the exception. You are not being tested on the 11-month rule where you have to pay duties. So here you are not, if you returned it within 11 months, or anything which is beyond 8 months, as far as domestic animals for pasturage purposes are concerned, then you're gonna have to, you fall within the general rule, not within an exception, but customs examiners say clearly this is an exception. So D is actually incorrect answer, right? And you have A, B, C, and E, which actually fit the question asked. Now, is this where you stop and you say, custom examiner, therefore, if I picked A, B, C, or E, I should get a credit? Well, you may, but this is, I think you may go a little bit further. I think you may go a little bit further and kind of drive point home that this question is actually stands for what it is being asked. And one way, what it is being asked, I'm sorry. And one way you can do that is look at the history, look at the record of the prior examinations and see if customs examiners tested on this topic and see how they have tested on this topic. So, in fact, the review of the history shows that customs examiners indeed have tested on this topic before, and indeed they tested it several times. So let's take a look at how these questions, the question on this regulation, have been asked before. So first question, the most recent question on this topic comes up in April 2001. License Custom Broker Examination, question 75. So let's dive into the question 75. Okay, almost there. Okay, 75. All right. So let's take a look. Dutiable merchandise imported and afterwards exported. So far, so good, right? Is subject to duty on every subsequent importation to customs territory of the United States, even though it may have been duty paid for on first importation. Now, here's where we see a departure. Which one of the following is not an exception? So, as opposed to this 2016 April question where they are looking for exception, here customs examiners explicitly state which one is not an exception, which and we look at the domestic animal, here we have 1 year or 12 months. This is obviously the correct answer, right? Because we are looking for the one which is not an exception. As opposed to this one, which is an exception. So that's one portion of the history. If you go a few years back, so let's so this is April 2001, question 75. Let's go to a few years back to April 1999 examination. So in April 1999, examiners proposed a similar question under question number 7. So let's see what they say about it. Okay. So again, as a general rule, dutiable merchandise is imported and afterwards exported, even though the duty may have been paid on the first importation. So that's a general statement of rule. So far, so good. It is subject to duty on every subsequent reimportation. Now, look at how they phrase the question in April 1999. All of the four following are exception to the general rule, except. So in other words, they're looking for exception to an exception, right? So this makes sense, and we're looking at I think they have domestic animals also within 1 year period. So now we have at least two statements on record where customs examiners proved that they're able to ask the question they look for, and they're pretty explicit. Here, there is no reason to question the explicitness or the methodology of customs examiners except to the answer key, right? Because we know that customs examiners can ask the question the way they wanted to, at least when it concerns 141.2. But here they decided not to test on the exception to the exception, or as they phrased it in April 2001, on the following choices that correctly fill on which of the following is not an exception. So in 99 they said exception to the general except, exception to the exception, and then 2001 they said is not an exception. Here they stated neither, they decided to go directly to the exception, which made A, B, C, and E correct, and the actual answer choice D, which customs examiners picked as correct answer choice, it does not fit the criteria of the correct answer under the question asked. All right? So this is the another reason to present your analysis to customs and to ask customs to review this question one more time and make a reconsideration with respect to the correct answer. Okay. So we are dealing with a drawback claim. It just says a drawback claim and it says timing requirement. So let's take a look. So upon review of a drawback claim, if the claim is determined to be incomplete or the claim, the claim will be rejected and customs will notify the filer in writing. The filer shall then have the opportunity to complete the claim subject to requirements for filing a complete claim within, and we have the listed timing requirements. All right, so according to customs examiners, the correct answer to question 48 is E, which is 3 years. 3 years. Customs says that reason they say this is because of regulation 191.52. Okay, so 191.52. Let's take a look at the regulation. So 191.52, perfecting, amending, or rejecting the claim. If you take a look at the paragraph A, you can see it. The filer shall have the, so if the claim is rejected, as was said in question 48, right? So question 48 said the claim is rejected. All right, or will be rejected either in a hypothetical form. We'll have opportunity to complete the claim subject to the requirements for filing complete claim within 3 years. So it has a 3-year requirement. You must complete the claim within 3 years, and if you're outside of that window, then you're not okay. It seems to be pretty straightforward, right? Filing completion, that 3-year filing completion claim is also comes from 151E, right here, time of filing, right? And it says 3-year period, right? Shall be filed within 3 years. And 3-year period, the time clock starts ticking from the date of exportation. 3 years from the date of exportation. All right, so that's what the regulation says. What's the problem with that? Let's go back to the customs license broker exam and we'll say we need to complete the statement of the regulation. Now, the regulation is pretty much straightforward. It says 3 years. The answer choice is E. So what is the problem? All right. So when was the exam held? Exam held on April 4th, 2016. Before exam, February 24th, Mr. Obama signs into the law H.R. 644, also known as Trade Facilitation and Trade Enforcement Act of 2015. Let's take a look at the Trade Facilitation and Trade Enforcement Act of 2015, which is linked over here. So it's a congressional official page. And let's take a look at section, it has many things, but let's take a look at, let's see, miscellaneous provisions, drawback and refunds, section 906, section 906, let's scroll down. Two. Two. Let's scroll down to J. Filing of drawback claims. All right. So, Section 313R of the Tariff Act of 1930, 1313R, so we have this USC 1313R, and 1330R, this regulation 159 9152 is based on 19 USC 1313R. All right, it's amazing by striking 3-year requirement and a certain 5-year requirement, all right? So what do we have here? So we have a Congress coming in, Obama coming in, signing the law in February, making into the law Trade Facilitation and Trade Enforcement Act of 2015 on February 24th, which says no more 3 years. You have 5 years. So now when you look at the law will be looking like that. So you go to United States Code. Well, actually, you don't need to do that. You can go straight into the hyperlink, and you can see that the R filing of drawback claims. A drawback entry shall be filed no later than 5 years after the date of the merchant at which drawback claim was imported. Claims not complete within 5-year period shall be considered abandoned. So no more 3 years, but rather 5 years. Okay. Now, this means that we know that at least on April 4, 2016, customs examiners was testing you on the law, which was no longer, which basically has changed. Now, how can you make it to your advantage? How can you argue that customs should not have tested you on a law which is outdated? Well, we can go back and take a look at the purpose of the exam, which is again stated under Part 111. So, Part 111, customs, dealing with customs brokers, I believe it's 13, written examination, clearly states that the goal of the exam is to determine whether individual's knowledge of customs and related laws, regulations, and procedures, bookkeeping, accounting, and other appropriate matters necessary to render valuable services to importers and exporters. So the goal of the exam is to be able to render the valuable service. If you, as a licensed customs broker, use the old law and submit something which is, let's say, late, okay, customs will reject it. Will that be a valuable service to the importer? Probably not. The importer or your client will probably hate you for that because you did not provide the competent service. You must follow and you must be aware, or you, at least you are deemed to be aware of all the laws. So if the purpose is to determine if you can render the valuable service to clients, then it is not a good idea to test you on a law which is no longer valid. So if you are being tested on that, if you are being tested on that law, that means you are falling back on the old law, and falling back on the old law will not provide the individual, will not determine that individual's knowledge can render valuable service. Okay? Again, this is stated in the regulation. This is a fallback provision, so the argument goes along these lines. Customs examiners should not provide questions which are based on a law which is no longer relevant, has been outdated, or otherwise has been superseded, because it contravenes the purpose of the examination. Because of this, and again, we'll go back to the question itself. So we know it's 5 years. Do we see the 5-year answer choice in the among the possible answers? No, we don't. So the argument goes like this: because this law is no longer relevant, this question should not have been there in the first place. 5 years is not there. Therefore, no possible correct answer choice can be applicable. All right? So that's for question number 48. Next. Next one on the list is question number 63. So let's scroll down to 63. All right. So this deals with broker compliance. So according to the customs examiners, question 63 has a correct answer choice E. Based on 111.45, section 111.45. All right. So let's take a look at the question. So XYZ brokerage is located in New York. It is permitted to conduct customs business in the ports of New York, Florida, California, and Alabama. The individual qualifying the permit in New York leaves the brokerage. Which statement is correct? All right. So before you even dive in, what kind of inferences can you make based on the fact pattern provided? So we have XYZ brokerage. So first of all, we know that it can conduct customs business. What do you need to have to conduct customs business on behalf of someone else? So you need a permit. You need a license, and you need the power of attorney. So those are the basic prerequisites. So what about permit? So we know it's a corporate broker, right? So the license is corporate, which implies that you must have one individual licensed customs broker who is in a position of authority, such as an officer of the company. We also have permit rule. The permit can have be either national or local. Now, based on the reasoning, we know that it is permitted to conduct only in those jurisdictions, which means it doesn't have a national permit. So we know that the permit that XYZ brokerage has are local permits, at least 1, 2, 3, 4. So we have at least 4 local permits. All right. So what else? So we know that New York person, New York permit qualifier lives. And the rule cited by the customs examiners is pretty much 180-day rule where they need to replace the person holding the permit. So let's take a look at, let's go to the CFR first. So let's go to 111.45 and refresh our memory with respect to the permit rule timing. All right, so permit here. Okay, so permit, if a broker who has not been granted a permit for additional district fails for any continuous period of days to employ within a district at least one person who holds a valid individual's broker license, that failure will, in addition to any other sanction, may be imposed on the party, result in the revocation of the permit by operation of law. All right, so permit is gone. So let's take a look at, let's go back to the question. So E is a correct answer choice, according to customs. XYZ brokerage has 180 days to replace the individual qualifying the permit in New York. All right, so having said that, let's take a look at the other answer choice. Let's take a look at B. The broker may demonstrate to the port director in New York that the licensed individual qualifying in Alabama permit can exercise responsible supervision and control over the business in New York. Okay, what's that? Well, just falling back of 111.45, we can see that we have this exception rule, right? Stated in 111.19. Okay. So, first of all, let's take a look at the region in the definition 111.1 region. Means geographic area covered by the waiver. Okay. And it goes back to 111.19. So let's go to 111.19 and see what the waiver provision says. So waiver provision is exception to the district rule is under 111.19D, right? So pretty much it says, if the applicant can demonstrate that he regularly employs at least one individual broker in a larger geographical area in which a district is located, and so we're talking about what? We know that we have Alabama, we know we have Florida, right? So that's larger geographical district, geographical area as opposed to New York, right? CBP may waive, so the key is if they are able to show that they are responsible to exercise adequate supervision and control, and they have adequate procedures in place, CBP may waive the requirement for individual broker in a district, right? So all of what you need to do is you need to demonstrate that a person, let's say from Alabama, can exercise responsible supervision and control over New York office, such as by flying in there regularly, such as telecommuting there on a regular basis, such as communicating with employees, such as providing training from the Alabama location, This is can be indicia of responsible supervision and control so far as Alabama district permit qualifier can show that there are adequate procedures in place. He can apply for the waiver for the New York office. Waiver for the for to have a permit. Okay? Under part 111.19D. All right? So this would be the legal fallback provision. Okay, so now let's take a look at the state qualifying Alabama permit. So Alabama permit qualifier can exercise responsible supervision and control, which is explicitly provided under 111.9D, over the business conducted in New York. If they can show that they have adequate set of procedures in place, they can qualify for the exception. Therefore, this 180-day rule will no longer be relevant. They can conduct business as such, but they need to have approval and they need to secure that exception, which means B is a correct statement. If you combine 111.45 plus 111.19 together. But is it a better statement than just the statement E, as customs examiners say it is? Yes, and again, the reason, as stated before, to analyze and to get to E, you have to only look at 111.45. It's a straight answer rule. Yes, check, move on. But to get to the answer B, you need to analyze the 111.19D through the prism of 111.45. You need to understand that there are multiple permits involved and there is no national permit. You need to analyze multiple regulations, and this shows that your cognitive ability, your analytical ability to kind of glide through the customs laws on a customs broker exam is at the higher level for if you pick answer choice B as opposed to answer choice E. Therefore, the higher analytical ability means that you are able to provide even more valuable service to the client, which is the goal of the exam. Therefore, B should be the better answer than E. So that's number 63. All right. Next. Question 65. All right, question 65. Follows right along question 64, and we have a question, simple one sentence question. What is the deadline for licensed customs broker to file a status report? So as you are on the way of becoming a licensed customs broker, you should be aware that every 3 years need to file what's colloquially known as triennial report, right? Or pay, sometimes customs jargon says triennial fee, right? So what is this referring to? Well, ever since 1985, there is a fee, right? And that, I think it's $100. And that fee must be paid, and it must be accompanied by the report updating the status. Are you actively involved in customs business? Have you committed any crimes? In other words, what customs looking is a review of your qualification to be fit to conduct customs business as a licensed customs broker. And this is done every 3 years. Now, the question is, which 3 years, right? So what is the deadline? So, well, by looking at the, again, critically looking at the question 65, we see the word deadline, right? And we see the word status report. All right. So let's take a look. Just let's scroll through the answer choices, just to get and kind of like to get a feel of the way they're being asked. So we're given a date and they say of the reporting year. Okay, so that makes sense. Of the reporting year of the status report, right? You can combine those two together, right? Of each year. Now that's ambiguous. Of each year of what? All right? Probably each year. Every year. Okay, you can kind of make sense, right? Because there is no years in between, right? Then you have a statement each third year. And in fact, according to customs CBP, question 65C, so CBP says C is the right answer choice. All right, so February 1st of each third year. What is the each third year? Is it third year beginning 1992? Is it third year beginning 1999? Is it third year beginning 1985? It doesn't say so. So it can be anything, right? So you have that ambiguity. Each third year. Third year statement. No reference to the initial year. So, whenever you're taking an examination, at the very least that customs examiners can do is to, navigating through the customs regulations, given the time constraints that you are given, is difficult enough. At the very least, customs examiners can at least give you the reference point to start with, right? They haven't done that. So they kind of like left you in a time vortex, right? And you kind of like have to kind of supposed to guess, okay, third year, based on what? Based on maybe 1985, maybe another year, custom examiners are not saying. But they're saying there is a best answer, right? So we have another third year, and then we have a second year. So that ambiguity is not a very nice thing to do. But that's not fatal, because it's triennial, right? What is fatal is if you look at the regulation itself, which provides for the triennial status report. And we can, triennial status is codified in 111.30D. And as you read carefully, you can see that, yes, there is a statement of general rule that the file report, the status report, which is referred to the in question 65, it must be filed on third year, beginning from every third year, beginning from February 1st, 1985, right? Now, what's the deadline? Okay. So on one hand, in the first sentence, they do say February 1st. But then take a look. The report must be accompanied a report received during the month of February will be considered to be filed timely. All right? So if you file on, let's say, February 9th, and customs receives it on February 15th. Does it mean you haven't met the deadline? All right. So the question of deadline is erased, because the regulation requires customs to treat those reports as filed timely, meaning that they might have their deadline. That's what it means, filing timely, right? so long as the report is received during the month of February. So the notion of filing timely is extended to the whole month of February. So the deadline, they cannot say, okay, rejected because you haven't met the deadline. No. What you have to look at is when did you receive it? This is a new deadline which regulations interpose. And according to the regulations, it is a whole month of February. Now, but that's not even the end of the story. Let's take a look at the paragraph 4, which says failure to file timely. So if the broker fails to file a report by March 1st, the broker license is suspended by operational law. So now the March 1st is the regulatory deadline, because the regulations prohibit Customs and Border Protection, they prohibit U.S. Customs from taking any action if unless the report is not filed after March 31st. So, in other words, you have a month of February, so you have a kind of like a deadline flexibility here. You have a February, and then you also have March 1st. So if I come into customs, if I walk in and I, on March 1st of the reporting year, and I submit my report, will customs do anything? Will I meet my deadline? Well, according to this, they cannot do anything. So the deadline entails a concept that this is the last day for you to file, and if you file afterwards, then you are late, right? But then you have erosion of this deadline, or kind of like a second definition of the deadline to March 1st, right? And you also have the erosion of the deadline to the whole month of February. Because if you file it on the last day of February and it is considered timely, customs cannot come to me and say, if customs receives it on the last day of February, they say, oh, you haven't met the deadline. I say, what do you mean? It's filed timely. It's still filed within February. It's the last day, I understand, but it is still the February, last day of February of the reporting year. So within the regulation, by the definition of regulation, the deadline can be interpreted as whole month of February and also as March 1st. So looking at the answer choices, we do not have either whole month of February reporting year, nor we have March 1st of the reporting year. So the argument will go as mentioned in my speech, and the argument would be for no possible correct answer, because the concept of deadline cannot, the regulations take away this February 1st concept of deadline, because they state that anything filed during the month and received by customs during the month of February is timely. And that timely, that statement timely, negates the phrase deadline. All right? So that's question 65. Next on the list is question 77. Okay, 77. All right, so we have ever-increasing in popularity question on intellectual property rights. Which of the following is not provided under part 133? To dispose of merchandise seized for infringement of a trademark recorded with U.S. Customs and Border Protection. All right, so Customs says D is the correct answer, if I am not mistaken. So let's take a look. So 77D, according to Customs, is the right answer choice. And they go to the something called 153.51B, 133.52AC, and they say, they just say the regulation here, however, they went beyond that. Then they said, under the relevant regulation in 19 CFR 133, part 133, merchandise seized for bearing a counterfeit mark may not be released with the mere obliteration of offending mark, as it is expressly forbidden under 133.51B and 133.52AC. So we have express prohibitions under those sections. So let's go in and check to see what those prohibitions say. So we have 133. Then we go to 151B. All right. And we have a statement. In appropriate cases, relief from the forfeiture may be granted to a petitioner for relief upon the following, right? And we're talking about there can be obliteration, but there is, remember, customs examiners actually stated in answer choice, there is express prohibition. And what they're referring to is this state, except for articles bearing a counterfeit trademark. So counterfeit is a spurious mark, meaning that it's a mark which is identical to the mark of the owner, which is which has registered its mark in the United States. Of course, subject to this lever rule and subject to the gray rule restriction, but customs examiners here do not give us that option to entertain. They pretty much says infringement of a trademark. Usually if there is infringement, it's usually how you're dealing in the area of counterfeit. All right, so so we're looking for the statement that is not provided where you can kind of dispose it. All right, so meaning that all the other statements are provided, right? So forfeiture followed by the destruction of infringing mark, all right? So we know that there is a forfeiture because customs can take it. So let's see. So, according to customs, release of infringing merchandise after obliteration is not allowed. So, we saw the express prohibition here. So, it is not provided in in a part 133. Forfeiture followed by destruction can be allowed. Release of infringing merchandise by a gift to charitable institution can be allowed. And exportation without obliteration of the offending mark when it is one other than counterfeit can be allowed. But we're usually talking about the infringement. So we are talking about counterfeit mark. So C is not really relevant, right? So, and it is provided for, as we shall see. So we'll take a look at A, B, C, D, E. So customs says D, right? So we'll leave that for later. Exportation for future release of infringing by way of gift to charitable institution. So let's take a look at So customs, in addition to 133.51, they mentioned 133.52. Again, we have this exception other than articles bearing counterfeit mark. And remember, in the fact pattern, customs mentioned that the mark is subject to the counterfeit provisions. So then there is again this express exception provided by customs examiners in their statements, in addition to 133.51 and 133.52 in the answer choice, which again is rare, which shows that customs went beyond the regular standard approach of just merely stating the regulation. So going to the 133.52, we can see that shall be disposed in accordance with the procedure applicable to forfeiture violation after removal of obliteration of the mark, right? And articles bearing counterfeit mark, they must be destroyed. So this means that, let's take a look. Destruction is available, so it's this one is provided. So A is provided for. Then release by way of gift to charitable institution. We have this gift of charitable institution clause here, right? Subject to trademark owner consent, of course. So this means that B is available, right? Provided for under part 133. Okay. Exportation of infringing merchandise without, if it is other than counterfeit. So if it's other than counterfeit at all, it is also available under part 133. Now, let's go to the D. Okay. So, release of infringing merchandise after obliteration when offending mark is counterfeit. So, remember those except for counterfeit, right? So, if it's counterfeit, 133.51 and 133.52 do not provide any exception for release, right? So, customs based on 133.51 and 133.52 go on and say, look, there is no recourse, it's counterfeit mark, so there is no way you can get it. Is that the end of the inquiry? According to customs, it is, because the call of the question is which one is not provided, right? So there is no recourse, right, under part 133. And of course, none of the above is not, it's kind of like applicable because this is provided, right? And versus not provided. So there is a check mark here because you have at least customs saying that this is provided. And if those are provided, then none of the above is not applicable. So those are not applicable, right? Because we're looking for the one that's not provided. And customs says D is not provided, therefore it is applicable. So I propose to look at another regulation, meaning another section of the part 133. And I'm talking about part 133.21. So this is a counterfeit section that's dealing with counterfeit merchandise. Article suspected of bearing counterfeit mark. All right. So take a look at the G. Consent of the mark owner, failure to make appropriate disposition. So one way to try to get your merchandise out is if it is suspected of infringement, of counterfeiting, is to go through the petition, which the question, the fact pattern in the question suggests, and which those sections do. So petition process, you need to go to the fines, penalties, and forfeiture officer, file a petition to for relief, and navigate through laws according to the custom standard. That's one way. Another way, you can go straight to the owner of the mark. According to one, and we're talking about the 133. So we have section 133, 21G regulation here. We have the statement which says the owner of the mark within 30 days from notification of seizure may provide a written consent to the importer allowing for importation of seized merchandise in its condition as imported or its exportation entry after obliteration of the mark or other appropriate disposition. So, in other words, part 133 does provide for applicability of the mark which is suspected of being counterfeit. So, if the merchandise is seized, there is an allegation that it's counterfeit, correct? If there is no allegation, why would it be seized? It is under the regulation section which provides for articles suspected of bearing counterfeit mark, right? So therefore, if you make a stipulation, if you reach an agreement with the mark owner to the effect that they are, so the way you reach that agreement is you propose to pay a royalty or you propose to pay a fee for agreement to use his mark on your product. And if this is the case, then it is provided for 133. And the call of the question is, which of the following is not provided for under part 133? So part 133 D says, release of infringing merchandise after obliteration of an offending mark is a counterfeit. Well, according to 133.21G, if you reach an agreement where you agree to obliterate the offending mark, and the owner grants you consent, you put that stipulation, you reduce it to writing, then it is provided for under part 133, specifically section 21G. Therefore, it is, the answer choice D is, constitutes a part of 19 CFR 133. Therefore, it is not, it doesn't fit that not, right, not description. It's actually not available because it is provided for in part 133. So the answer choice, and E already discussed, it is negated by a possibility of A, B, and C. And now, as we discussed, D on the list. So the argument for question 77 would be there is no possible correct answer because those situations, the situations A through D, are contemplated by part 133, all right? So that this would be the rationale for the appeal for question 77. Now, question 80. It's the last question on the list. Last one, folks. So, let's see, question 80. Wow. International Trade Commission. Fun. So, question 80. Which of the following is true with respect to imported merchandise after U.S. International Trade Commission finds a violation of Section 337 of Tariff Act 19 U.S.C. 1337 and issues an exclusion order implemented by CBP under 19 CFR 12.39. Okay, so buzzwords. Exclusion order. All right. So customs examiners say that E is the correct answer. E. The argument is for D. So E says merchant is subject to exclusion order may not be entered after exclusion order that has been issued. But customs examiners say that the correct answer says merchandise subject to exclusion order may be entered under bond as provided for under 113, which is the part regulating bond conditions, etc., until the determination of a violation becomes final. So which one is correct, which one is not correct? Well, the focus is the buzzword, exclusion order. So customs examiners provide us with two points of law. So one of them is 19 CFR section 1239, which deals with unfair practices. Another one is the United States Code, the law, United States Code, the statute. USC, section 1337, unfair trade practice. It's a famous section. Its use is ever more increasing. Section 1337 investigations and exclusion orders apply mostly in the realm of intellectual property rights, such as patent infringement. It can also apply in situations where you have unfair trade practices such as Sherman Act, the 15 U.S.C. Section 1 antitrust violations. It can be applied in the areas of trademark laws. It can be applied in the areas of copyright laws. Again, the intellectual property rights area. It can also be to the more rare extent applied in the context of trade secrets violation. So if someone inadvertently discloses Coca-Cola formula, they may be liable to section 1337 investigation, and they will not be able to bring the product into the country using Coca-Cola formula. But let's take a look at the law. So since we are being tested on the regulation, let's go to the section 1239. Okay. Okay, unfair competition. Here it is. All right, let's see. So it's, and when you analyze this section, you should analyze it through the prism of the buzzwords that customs examiners provided you. And the key point here is the exclusion order itself, okay? Exclusion order. Why? Because customs examiners, in the answer choice, they did not specify the type of exclusion order. And under section 1337, we're going to go back to this concept, but I think it's just helpful to understand the legal background. So if you go to the law itself, 1337, you will be able to see that you have, again, without just diving deep into the law, you'll be able to see that you have a paragraph D where you can have exclusion of articles from the entry, of course, pursuant to the exclusion order period, and you have paragraph E, exclusion of articles from entry during investigation except under bond. So what it is you have a kind of like, almost like an injunction, right? You have investigation period, which can last easily 18 months, right? So it takes a long time. And of course, during the investigation period, because it lasts, so it's very fact-intensive inquiry, very scientifically driven. So what you have is you have a big span of time. The idea is by the time the investigation period is over, you will be, you can be wiped out, right? Because because of the infringing product or because of the damaging product which is being brought into the country. So the goal of the injured party is to kind of like stop this what's quote-unquote unfair trade practice, and they of course they need to show that this is unfair, and because unfair investigation period to show that unfairness can take so long, they can be wiped out. So what during the investigation period, what the ITC, International Trade Commission, which is has a jurisdiction pursuant over investigation pursuant section 337 of the Trade Act, 19 U.S.C. 1337, they have jurisdiction. What the ITC, International Trade Commission, has done is they issued their interim. There is an interim relief available, and so that interim relief is can be say, okay, we're going to issue what's called a temporary order, right? So not final, but temporary order. And that temporary order will be pursuant to this exclusion of articles. So the articles are excluded, but if you want to bring them in, you have to post a bond. And in case the investigation is over, that bond provision, right, will compensate the injured party adequately, at least to the extent that ITC determines is adequate. After investigation period is over, let's say the injured party is found to be in fact injured, so there is a final order of exclusion, and that final order, there is no bond possible. So we have two orders, right? Two exclusion orders here in play. We have in the interim temporary order pursuant to the section to the 1337 paragraph E, and we have final order pursuant to the paragraph D of 19 U.S.C. 1337. So this is the it is after this legal background the rule 19 CFR 1239 was drafted, and it was drafted very much similar to the way the actual law states. So for example, take a look, exclusion from entry under bond, notice of exclusion. So it contemplates exclusion from entry, and it contemplates entry under bond, so temporarily and final, right? If the commission finds the violation, so or has the reason to believe violation exists. So if they find a violation, which refers to the final the period after investigation, or believes that the violation exists, which refers to the interim relief portion, right? It may direct Secretary of Treasury, since this regulation, I don't think it has been changed since 9/11, 2001, let me see. Yeah, see, the last time it was amended was 2000, right? So what happened in 2002, the customs was transferred from U.S. Treasury Department to Department of Homeland Security. So reference to Secretary would be reference to Secretary of Homeland Security. But because it predates that transfer, the reference is made to Secretary of Treasury, all right? So let's go back to B. So you have the Secretary of Treasury to exclude from entry articles concerned which are imported or suspected of violating Section 337 of the Trade Act. So see, you have this interplay. Final violation, suspected violation. Temporary relief versus final relief, all right? So During the period the commission's exclusion order remains in effect, so we're talking about the interim because exclusion order, exclusion article may be entered under single entry bond to be sufficient to protect the injury. But then they go in and they say when the order becomes final, or if the order becomes final, articles covered by the determination will be refused entry period. So again, interplay temporary versus final. What's the problem with the question as it is asked? So unlike the context which was provided by the regulation, unlike the context which was provided by the statute, section 19 USC 1337, customs have not provided the context in the question provided. Here they simply ask for the exclusion order. They did not say final order, they did not say temporary order, they did not even provide a statement such as there is an investigation period which is still ongoing, or the investigation period is over. You have nothing to fall back on to make an inference that the merchandise subject to the exclusion order, according to customs, E, may not be entered after exclusion order has been issued. All right, I'm sorry, D. What am I saying? So, guys, CBP answer is D, right? Bond. Appealable answer is E. Okay, so it doesn't really matter. Because the argument is both inferences are equally the best answers. Both inferences are equally strong because there is no background. If customs had given even the slightest clue of what type of exclusion order they're talking about, they're talking about temporary or final, if they're given the period, the stage of the investigation, which they have not, right, in the fact pattern, then you could have made an inference. But without doing that, this D merchandise, which is subject to exclusion order, temporary exclusion order, maybe entered under bond, is just as good as merchandise subject to exclusion order, which may not be entered because the exclusion order became final, right? Merchandise subject to exclusion order may not be entered after the exclusion order has been issued, right? So here it is, customs examiners do a great service by not clarifying what type of exclusion order they are talking about here, what type of exclusion order they are talking about here, and here they are talking about also the exclusion order, right? But it's probably a different exclusion order, right? It's confusing, right? And the only way you can settle this confusion is by making a point that there is temporary exclusion order and there is final exclusion order. Because customs have not clarified whether it's temporary or final, both answers are equally valid answers under the fact pattern presented. So that has been question 80. I hope this lecture was at least instructive, as well as helpful. So again, suggested answers are, which I talked through, have been reduced in writing and are available at the store, right? But you're also welcome to try, based on my lecture, to make your own inferences and make your own writing. Additionally, there were some other questions which I saw that may qualify for appeal. I decided not to address them because I did not feel they were compelling enough. And again, the criteria is compelling, right? The questions that I did discuss, I think, are compelling enough to be addressed to customs. So that's it. Thank you for watching and good luck. Bye.